Welcome to today's lecture on the topic analysis of product purity. So today we'll be discussing about the importance of the purity of the samples when it comes to downstream processing. And for analyzing the product purity, we'll be studying about two important techniques that will be used usually, that is chromatography and spectrophotometer. So coming to the table of contents, so we will be studying about chromatography and spectrophotometer, as I told you. And under chromatography, we have different chromatographic systems. So we'll see a little bit highlight on the different systems that we have. And in spectrophotometer, we'll be studying about the UV visible spectrophotometer and the mass spectrophotometry. So coming to the analysis of product purity, and when it comes to chromatography, let us see it first about the working of adsorption chromatography. So we all know that adsorption chromatography is the one chromatographic technique that is widely used, where the molecules adsorb by either physical forces or chemical forces. So the weak physical forces might be van der Waals force, and this might be exploited for the separation. So the widely used adsorbents are silica, alumina hydroxide, alumina oxide, and many more. And there are a lot of studies which have been seen on use of natural materials, and even charcoal has been used as an adsorbing material for a lot of color removal and pigment removal and those kind of applications. And coming to adsorption desorption, that is the most important thing that you have to keep in mind, because we are using this chromatographic techniques to purify our products of interest. So it should not be like it is getting adsorbed and later it is not being desorbed. So it has to adsorb to the matrix, and then there should be conditions which are suitable for desorption, so that once the molecule is desorbed, it is in the purified form which can be used, which can be packaged and marketed. So coming to adsorption chromatography, so this is a diagram which gives you a detail about how adsorption chromatography works. So adsorption chromatography, you can see there is a matrix, that is the matrix which is used for adsorption, and these are the molecules, maybe the adsorbate, and this is called as the adsorbent. So this is the adsorbate which is getting adsorbed on the surface of an adsorbent. So this is one more diagram showing you how the solute molecules are getting attached on the surface of adsorbent. So that is how adsorption chromatography works. So next, let us see a little bit detail on the working of ion exchange chromatography. So here, you know, ion exchange chromatography basically works on the principle of electrostatic force of attraction between the solute and these adsorbing adsorbate molecules and the adsorbent molecules. So basically, in this kind of system, we have something called as the ion exchange resins, and they are classified under two categories, that is cationic exchangers or anionic exchangers. And I've highlighted few examples, like with the groups which are commonly used for cationic exchanger production and the groups which are usually used for the anionic exchanger systems. So this is a typical diagram that shows you how an anionic exchanger works. So you can see there is a resin which is used for separation. So this resin will be there in the column. So if you are using a chromatographic column, the resin will have a particular material, and that resin is shown here. And it is equilibrated, and the charge on the resin in this particular case of anionic exchanger is maintained positive. So by using an ionic system here, we know that the resin has positive charge. And now a solute system that is required, which we want to separate the negative ions from that system, is sent through this resin or through this column. So when this happens, you can see there that initially you have a negative ion that is attached on the surface, but once you have a more electronegative molecule, this gets attached to the surface, and the less electronegative molecule gets detached. So you can see there, this might be the product of interest in this particular case. So that is why you can see with continuous operation of the system, continuously this negative charge is getting displaced, and this the more electronegative molecule gets attached on the surface. So in this way, finally, all the less electronegative molecules are getting removed, and the more electronegative molecules are getting attached to the matrix. So by varying the retention time, finally you can dissolve this particular molecule which has been attached, and finally you have a purified product with you which can be further polished, which can be packaged and then marketed. So in this way you can try to use anionic exchangers or cationic exchangers based on the requirement and based on the product purity and the property of your sample that you have. So basically, if you have a electronegative molecule of interest that you want to separate, then it's better to use an anionic exchanger. But if you want to separate an electropositive material, then you have to use a cationic exchanger. So in the case of cationic exchanger, the resin will have a negative charge and this will be positive. And the more electropositive molecule will get attached and less electropositive molecule will get detached. So in this way, you can use this kind of ion exchange systems for separation. So basically, it is based on charge, electrostatic force of attraction between the charges. That's why the system and this system works on this principle. So coming to the third system of chromatography, that is affinity chromatography. So this kind of system works on very much specificity. It is very specific system. So some examples for affinity chromatography are either enzyme substrate, antigen antibody, enzyme inhibitor. So these are the few systems which are widely used for affinity chromatography, which are very, very specific. And I've highlighted few examples which have been already used for this application, okay, for purification of human leukocytes. They have immobilized the monoclonal antibodies in the column. So you can see there is a chromatographic column made up of sephirose, and in that column, monoclonal antibodies have been attached, and they're using that monoclonal antibodies for purification of human leukocytes. So in this way, you can try to use even affinity chromatography for enhancing the purity of the samples. So this is the principle how it works. So you can see you have a sephirose matrix, that is what I showed you, and this might be the ligand, that is nothing but like something like your monoclonal antibodies which are attached. Okay, and now you have a complex with you, and now you bring in the sample which you want to get removed from the entire mass that you have. So this is one of the sample in the mixture. Okay, there are multiple samples, but only this sample of your interest can bind to this. So it is something like a lock and key model. So you can see only these molecules can bind to this complex that we have, whereas any other molecule of different shape and size will not get attached, and those will be called as the impurities. So finally, your complex is there, and by changing the pH or ionic strength, there can be desorption done, and that is how you get your purified molecule with you. So in this way, you have enriched your product now, because you removed all of these, right? You removed all of this, and finally your matrix had only one kind of molecule, and finally you're desorbing it to remove this molecule. So in this way, you're trying to purify your samples using this technique of chromatography. And in particular, this example is for affinity chromatography. Coming to the one more system that we have in chromatography, which is called as the reverse phase chromatography. Okay, the name reverse phase because in this particular system, the matrix is made hydrophobic. Usually, if the matrix is hydrophilic, it is normal phase. Okay, so in this case, since the matrix itself is made hydrophobic, we call it as reverse phase chromatography. So in this way, you can try to remove certain hydrophobic molecules using this reverse phase chromatography. So we have to take care about the use of matrix in this particular case. So I'll show you a diagram which explains it even better. So you can see here you have a hydrophobic stationary phase. Okay, so your phase itself is hydrophobic, and you can see now I have my sample with me which has a mixture of hydrophilic proteins and hydrophobic proteins. So since our phase here is hydrophobic, it has affinity only for hydrophobic molecules, whereas hydrophilic molecules cannot attach to this matrix, so that moves out fast. So in this way, you can separate your hydrophilic proteins from hydrophobic proteins. For this, you should know about the properties of your proteins that you are interested in. So definitely, if your protein of interest is hydrophobic, you can try to use this. Or even if your protein of interest is hydrophilic, then also you can try to use this system. So when your system is, your protein of interest is hydrophilic, definitely you know this is going to elute out fast, right? So since this is eluting out fast, you have your purified product with you at a faster rate, and you can further purify it, polish it, package it. So those steps can be done easily. So trying to use this system will be very, very essential, and it will be useful when you know the property of your sample, whether it is hydrophilic or hydrophobic. So in case if it is hydrophobic, that also the system can be used. So you can see that hydrophobic molecules are getting attached, and later by changing the pH and ionic strength, we can try to desorb these molecules and try to purify this. So this also can be purified separately, and this also can be purified separately. So in this way, once you purify it, you have an enriched product with you. And these are a few diagrams to show you how a column looks like. Okay, so this is a reverse phase chromatography system, that is the C18 column. So these are the column examples which are given there. The pictures, you can have a look at it. And one more system that we have under chromatography is gel filtration chromatography. Okay, so the name tells you, gel filtration chromatography. So these are the gel molecules. So you can see there, these are porous gels, okay, porous beads, which have pores inside. Okay, so that helps in separation. So you can see the entire column is filled with this bead materials. And you're trying to use this for separation, as I told you, and these beads are porous in nature. And now my sample has got some big molecules and some small molecules. So what happens in the system is the small molecules will take more time to elute, because it will move through the pores. All the pores, it will start moving through the pores and finally come out. So that will take more time. But if you have big molecules, it cannot enter the pores. So it cannot enter the pores, so it will move to the space between the pores, and in that way it comes out. So the bigger molecules will move faster, whereas the smaller molecules take more time to move. So in this way, you can separate your bigger macromolecules, proteins, with smaller proteins. So in this way, you can try to purify your proteins present in a mixture. So even this is one system that we have, which can be utilized for purification of your samples. So that is why we are studying this particular topic in this particular lecture. So then we have recent advancements now, that is use of GC, use of HPLC. So those kind of instruments are also there. So GC works on gas chromatography. It is called as gas chromatography, which works on the principle of the analyte getting volatilized. Okay, so only if that analyte has the capability to volatilize and they are stable at that particular conditions, then you can analyze that sample using GC. Okay, it is gas chromatography. So in this particular case, the partition coefficients are inversely proportional to the volatility of the analytes. So the most volatile compound will elute out first, whereas the least volatile compound will elute out last. Okay, so in this way, various detector systems are required for analysis. So these are like, you might have heard about GCMS, okay, gas chromatography mass spectrophotometry. So in this way, various detector systems are there. And once you have a detector system, and once you have a mass spec with that, you have the quantitative analysis that you can do it. Whereas only if GC is there, you will have a qualitative analysis. So GCMS will help in quantitative analysis of various products. So this is a typical diagram to show you how a GCMS system looks like. Okay, so this is the carrier gas which is used for the volatilization, and this is the flow control that we have, and these are the sample injection ports, and this is the column which is used for separation. Okay, so this is within the entire column oven, and you have the detector which is used to detect the signal, and the waste is eluted out here, and the signal, the analysis result is given here in the chromatogram. So based on this chromatogram results, we can find out if a given compound of your interest is there in the sample or not. So for that, you'll have to do certain standards first, and the method has to be optimized to know whether your molecule of interest is getting analyzed in that particular system of method that you have chosen. Okay, so if you are doing the standards and you get a particular peak, so you can do a standards of like different concentrations and see if there is a variation in the peaks and standardize the method first. And once you standardize the method, you can send in your sample and see what is the concentration of your sample. And if that particular retention time, now imagine this is the graph for the standard. And similarly, you are getting almost similar peaks, but you have a little less peak here. That tells that this particular compound is there in your sample, but the purity of that sample might be slightly less. So then you may have to work on some more DPT steps to enhance the purity, and then again run a GCMS to see if you get almost same peak. So now if you get almost same peak, that is an indication that you have done your steps right and you're getting so much concentration of that particular product. So So in this way, GCMS can be widely used for analyzing the product purity. Apart from GCMS, we have other systems also like LCMS, that is called as liquid chromatography mass spectrophotometry. Okay, so that also can be used for a lot of analysis, and a lot of pesticides, dyes and all are analyzed using LCMS. So a little bit details on HPLC itself. Okay, this is also one more system, high pressure liquid chromatography. Okay, so this LCMS is the new technique. This is slightly older one, HPLC. So we have recent advancements coming up. So this is the working of HPLC that I'm highlighting now. So in HPLC, the operating pressure is very high, that is 5.5 into 10 raised to 7 pascals. So in this pressure range, this instrument will be working. And in, same as in the case of GC, we have various detector systems that can be used. And you can see there, you have UV detectors, RI detectors, or mass spec detectors. So based on what you're trying to analyze, you can use a suitable detector systems. So you can see if you try, you are trying to analyze certain proteins, amino acids, nucleic acids, you can use a UV detector. But if you're doing some analysis on sugars or carbohydrates, then you can use RI detectors, okay? And if you're trying to analyze certain molecular structures, you want to know the structure of it, then mass spec detector should be used, because you will get to know the mass of the molecule, and from the mass, you can find out the structures, okay? So there are softwares for that to find out the structure based on mass, and that can be used for analyzing the structure of the molecules. And this might be very, very useful when you're doing some pathway analysis. So if you're doing some degradation studies, or if you're doing some other studies where you want to find out the degradation pathway, then for that, this mass spec detectors should be used, and the structures which you get in the intermediate stage will be very, very useful in analyzing the pathways. So the next important technique that we have for analyzing the product purity is spectrophotometer. Okay, so this is working on the principle of Beer-Lambert's law. Okay, so we will see what is that. So in case of these spectrophotometric analysis, a lot of analysis can be done. So you can find out the purity of a sample. You can check whether RNA, DNA is present. So all that can be checked if you just run a sample through a spectrophotometer and check at various wavelengths. So at a wavelength of 260 and 280, we are usually checking it. So I'll tell you the importance of that now. Okay, so before that, we should know how this works. So as I told you, it is working on the principle of Beer-Lambert's law. So this is how it is working on. So here you try to find out the optical density, which is also called as the absorbance. Okay, so you can find out the absorbance of the samples. So it is based on the log of intensity of the incident light to the intensity of transmitted light. Okay, so we will see what is that. One second. So you have the Beer-Lambert's law, as I told you. And this is the Beer-Lambert's law, what it states. So absorbance measured is directly proportional to epsilon into B into C, where B is the path length and C is the concentration of the analyte, and epsilon is the wavelength dependent molar absorptivity coefficient. So this is the coefficient, this is the path length, and this is the concentration. So more is the concentration, more will be the absorbance. So it is directly proportional. Okay, so once you get more absorbance value, that will tell you that there is more concentration of that product in that particular sample that you have. So indirectly, it tells you the purity of the sample. So more concentration means definitely the sample is more pure, right? So in this way, you can use the system, a simple UV spectrophotometer can be used to check the purity of the sample. So imagine you're doing this experiments, and initially you find out the absorbance. So you are doing some protein, imagine, and you check the protein spectrum at 260 and 280 before doing any optimization. So imagine you're doing it as it is, you get some protein and you want to check its absorbance. So once you do that, you may get an absorbance value of 0.1 or 0.2. So that tells you that the concentration is less, right? Because it is directly proportional. So if OD value is less, that means your concentration is less. And then might be after varying some parameters, by doing some optimization, you might improve your product, and using various DPT steps again, you may try to enrich your product. So once you have used those DPT steps and you feel that you have enriched your product, you again run a UV spectrophotometer for the same sample. So now imagine you're getting an absorbance of like 0.9 or 0.95, okay? Or if you are getting more than one, you may have to dilute your samples and take the reading. So when you dilute the sample and take your reading, if you're getting 0.5 and you have used 10 times dilution, then you can multiply by the dilution factor and find out the actual absorbance. And once you get your actual absorbance, you can find out the actual concentration. So in this way, you'll get to know whether your sample is getting purified by the steps that you're doing or not. Okay, so in this way, this UV visible spectrophotometer or any spectrophotometer for that purpose, even visible spectrophotometers are there. So these kind of spectrophotometer systems will be very, very useful in analyzing the product purity. So this is how the system works. You can see you have a cuvette, okay, well, the cuvette is used here. And you should be very careful when selecting the cuvette, okay? Because when you're working in UV region, you're supposed to use a quartz cuvette, okay? And when you're using a visible region, you're supposed to use a glass cuvette. So in the cuvette, if you have observed carefully, they would be written Q. So if it is written Q there, that means it's a quartz cuvette. So that is very useful when you're doing any reading in the UV region. So within the UV region, you have to use a quartz cuvette. So this is the intensity of the incident light. And this is the intensity of the transmitted light. Okay, so you can see that this is after passing the sample, this light is coming out. So if there are more molecules in this, if the concentration is more, then this incident, the light which is coming out will be less. But if the concentration is less, then this I might be almost similar to I naught. Okay, so and this is the path length of the cuvette. So in this way, this you can see here, log of intensity of incident light to the log of intensity of transmitted light. So if the incident light and transmitted light values based on that, you can calculate your optical density. Because if the denominator is going to decrease, then definitely our numerator will increase, right? So optical density value is going to increase when the transmitted light is going to decrease. Because you can see there, as per the equation, it is inversely proportional. So if the intensity of the transmitted light decreases, then the optical density increases, which internally tells you that the concentration of the sample is more. Okay, so once the concentration is more, then only this will become less. So coming to the last topic of today's lecture, that is determination of sample purity. So you can see here, you can check the sample purity using the absorbance values at 260 and 280. So these are the two wavelength ranges where you have to analyze your sample. So for example, a pure DNA sample, okay, if you have a pure DNA sample, it always yields a 260 by 280 ratio of approximately 1.8. So you have to make a UV spectrum at absorbance 280, and you have to make it at 280 also, 260 also, sorry, two wavelengths you have to take, and you have to divide the 260 value that you get with 280 value. And when you divide this, if you're getting approximately 1.8, then that tells you that the sample that you have, the DNA sample, is pure. And similarly, for RNA sample, this ratio should yield a value of 2. Okay? So these ratios are commonly used for assessing the contaminants. So if there is any protein contaminants within this RNA or DNA samples, then we know that proteins will absorb at 280. So if proteins are absorbing at 280, definitely my ratio is going to change and I will not get the value in this range. So if I'm not getting my value in this range for my DNA sample, that indirectly tells me that there is protein contamination in my sample. And similarly for RNA, if I'm not getting 2, because proteins are absorbing at 280, I will get a ratio less than whatever is given here. And that's indirectly telling you that there is protein contamination in your RNA sample. So once you know there is a protein contamination, you have to think how to remove these proteins from my sample. Then again, run a UV visible spectrophotometer. And this time, since the proteins are not there, this value will decrease. And if this value decreases, the overall ratio will come close to 2. So by finally analyzing these ratios, you will get to know if there are certain protein contaminations. And once you do some DPT steps to remove these proteins, finally, again, you can run a UV spectrum and check if you're getting the ratios right. So if you're getting the ratios right, that tells you that the protein has been successfully removed from the sample and your sample is pure. So that is how you're checking the purity of the sample using a spectrophotometer. So you have a mass spec systems also, which can be attached. Okay, so these are the powerful tools that can be used. So I was talking about chromatography, right? So there you can see that the systems can be used. So mass spec will help in giving the quantitative analysis of the sample. And this can be coupled with LC, as I told you, LC-MS. And this can be used for analysis of a lot of proteins and peptides. So in this way, you can use a UV spectrophotometer, or so you can use mass spectrophotometer for analyzing the product purity. Thank you for watching, guys. Do subscribe the channel for more updates.